Hello, my name's Cliff Frelick. I'm the Executive Director of Cinema St. Louis, and we are the presenters of the 29th Annual Whitaker St. Louis International Film Festival. We're really pleased to have you join us for this masterclass on directing with Ken Kwapis. I will introduce Ken more thoroughly momentarily, but first I want to give a few shout outs and make a few notes. First, we want to thank the sponsor of all of these masterclasses. We're doing a total of six through the course of this festival. Two more will occur next weekend. We have another one tomorrow on Sunday, same time, 1 o'clock. And that will be with Rachel Reichman, who's a terrific director of narrative films earlier in her career. And she has moved on to become an editor of documentary. And she is a co-director of a extraordinary documentary at this year's festival, Queen of Hearts, which Audrey Flack is the subtitle. I strongly recommend it. Her films are available also for free streaming under the films of Rachel Reichman. So I would strongly suggest that you take a look at those if you're going to participate in the class tomorrow. So we wanted to thank, and it popped up and disappeared, the Chalapa Vetivali Foundation, which is the logo that was briefly on your screen. They are the sponsors of all of those master classes. There it is again. Thank you. Our magic wizard behind the scenes, Chris Clark, my colleague. Thank you, Chris. And then I want to also introduce our co-presenter of all of these master classes, and that is Webster University Film Series, being represented quite ably by the head of the film series, Pete Timmerman. Pete, would you like to say a few words?
Yeah, thank you, Cliff. I just wanted to pipe up and say the Webster University Film Series is St. Louis's only nonprofit year-round movie theater. Usually we show movies in person in the Winifred Moore Auditorium on Webster's main campus in Webster Groves. But under the current circumstances, we haven't shown anything in person since mid-March, as you can imagine, and we won't be able to for a while yet. But I wanted to make sure that you all know that we are still going on. We've been booking new films. We tend to show, you know, like art house films, repertory films, new restorations, things like that. But we have been booking the type of thing that we would normally show in the main house in what we call our virtual theater. If you go to webster.edu/film series or on social media, we're at WU Film Series on both Instagram and Twitter, and at Webster Film Series on Facebook. You can see our programming. Any given time, we usually have between 1 and 3 new restorations, new films, things like that. They usually cost like $10 or $12, and we get half the proceeds. And we have been putting on some movie discussions and things like the one you're coming to today. But yes, thank you.
Thank you, Pete. Pete will be rejoining me when we pop back on after Ken's presentation. We'll be forwarding your questions and comments to Ken. So please remember that this is a participatory event. We want to hear from you. You have a chat on the event of stream that you're able to ask questions. You may want to wait a little bit until Ken gets close to the end of his presentation so things don't pile up too much, but feel free if something pops into your mind, please put it in the chat stream, and then Pete and I will then relay those questions to Ken. All right, now let me now get to the proper business of the day, and that is giving a thorough introduction to Ken Kwapis, who's a great friend of the festival. Ken has local roots. He grew up in Belleville, Illinois. He attended St. Louis University High, a high school that I hear way too much about because my colleague Chris Clark also attended there, and he is inordinately proud of that association. Ken is also a former Cinema St. Louis Award winner as a person who's doing significant work in the world of cinema with local roots. He's going to be drawing for this masterclass from his really terrific new book. It's called But What I Really Want to Do Is Direct: Lessons from a Life Behind the Camera. This book is both a memoir. It relates, obviously, a good portion of Ken's career, although it's reasonably selective. It's not thorough. He has way more to share at some future date, but he also gives really practical advice, extraordinarily, I think, useful advice to anybody who's going to become or hopes to become a director. And for that matter, there are lessons that I think can be applied to life in general in many instances that I think anybody who's interested in film is going to get a lot out of this. You do not have to be an aspiring director. Ken is an award-winning director who's moved easily between the worlds of feature filmmaking and television directing. He made his feature debut with Sesame Street Presents Follow That Bird, and his 11 films include A Walk in the Woods with Robert Redford and Nick Nolte, License to Wed with Robin Williams and John Krasinski, The Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants, and He's Just Not That Into You, which were two highly successful adaptations of best-selling books, and Sexual Life, which he also wrote. Finally, he was, it's not finally, there are many others that I can name, but he also directed with his wife, Marissa Silver, He Said, She Said, which was written by another St. Louisan, Brian Holfeld. For television, Ken helped launch 9 series. He directed the pilot of the Emmy Award-winning series, The Office, receiving a 2007 Emmy nomination for the episode Gay Witch Hunt. He also earned an Emmy nomination as a producer-director of Malcolm in the Middle, and he directed the pilots for the groundbreaking The Larry Sanders Show and the Emmy Award-winning The Bernie Mac Show. His other TV work includes multiple episodes of The Santa Clarita Diet, Happy-ish, One Mississippi, and Freaks and Geeks. And honestly, that is just a sampling of what Ken has done over his career. He's really an extraordinarily talented person. We're very pleased to have him with us. We are now going to exit, Pete and I, and turn over the controls to Ken. We'll return later to relay your questions.
Thank you. I'm so excited to be here. Thank you, Cliff. And thank you, Pete. I'm a Cinema St. Louis fan, but I'm also a Webster film series fan. I've had many important film-going experiences at Webster, so I'm glad that Webster's a co-host. I'm going to be talking today about the craft of directing. I'm going to give you about a 55-minute presentation, after which I'd love to answer any and all questions you might have. I've been a director for 37 years, and as Cliff said, I've been blessed to go back and forth between features and television series. And over that time, I've directed a list. It's a list that I'm constantly revising, a list of directorial reminders, things to help me when I'm preparing a scene. And what I want to do for the next 50 plus minutes or so, I want to go through my list. There are 9 items. Some of them are very basic, others rather idiosyncratic. And occasionally I want to run a clip to illustrate a concept. And after that, what I want to do is show you a scene from a film I directed, The Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants, and discuss how I applied those directorial tips to that individual scene. So number one, the first item on my list is what I call the emotional roadmap. As a director, you need a clear understanding of every character's journey. I mean, part of your job on the set is to remind an actor where he or she is on that particular journey. And there are different ways to describe this journey. Some prefer the phrase through line or character arc, but I like the visual of a roadmap. So before digging into any particular scene, I will often step back and survey the map as a whole. Does the character have an overarching goal in the story? What circumstances shaped this character's life prior to the story? By the way, to answer that question, you can usually find clues in the script, but often not. If there is no obvious clue to a character's backstory, there may be some tidbit that allows you to invent circumstances about a character that will fire your actor's imagination, whether the actor is the lead in your story or merely has one line of dialogue. Oh, by the way, on the set, you do need to be attentive to all the actors, and that's a point I want to circle back to shortly. By the way, this concept of an emotional roadmap applies just as much to series as it does features. As Cliff mentioned, I helped launch NBC's series, The Office. The main character of that show, Michael Scott, played by Steve Carell, has a very clear overarching goal. Michael is convinced that he's a comedic genius, and his goal is to make sure that the documentary crew filming daily life at Dunder Mifflin Paper Company captures his comedic brilliance on display. So once you remind yourself of a character's overall goal, now let's focus on an individual scene. Is there a specific goal? And what tactics does your character employ to achieve that goal? The word tactics is a good segue to the second reminder on my list, and that is create playable, notes for your actors. Now, I have a hunch that some of you, probably quite a few of you out there, have acting experience, and you know how frustrating it is to get a note from a director that's simply not playable. If I say to an actor, make it funnier, well, sorry, that is not a playable note. That is what many call a result-oriented note. Another unplayable note, somebody, a director may give you a line reading. Let's consider the line from Scarface, say hello to my little friend. Okay, say hello to my little friend. An unimaginative director might ask or say to the actor, I want you to really land on the word friend. Say hello to my little friend. Well, okay, with this kind of note, you're essentially treating your actor like a dialogue spewing robot. Always better to remind your actor what he or she needs to achieve in the scene, and using active verbs, give them different tactics for how to achieve that goal. For instance, let's say you have a character who's trying to persuade someone to lend her $1,000. She might alternately plead, cajole, insist, beg. Those are all active verbs, ones that your actor can sink her teeth into. And personally, I love encouraging actors to change tactics from take to take. Remember the word tactics when we get to Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants. You'll notice I haven't said anything about visuals at all yet. That's because when I prepare a scene, I try to work from the inside out. I want to make sure that I grasp the emotional content first. Then I'll be able to pre-visualize the action in a way that supports the emotional content. But now let's add images. The third reminder on my list is simply this: tell your story with pictures. How much information can you convey without dialogue? Can you visualize the dynamic between the characters? And when I use the word dynamic, I'm thinking about, for instance, who has the upper hand in the scene, who has the high status. And if that dynamic shifts over the course of the scene, can you represent the change visually as opposed to relying on dialogue? Can you convey a character's intentions without speech? If your scene is about, let's say, a confident young attorney about to try her first case, what image conveys her sense of confidence? As an exercise, I really encourage you, especially if you're an aspiring director, to watch TV or films occasionally without any sound. Turn the sound off, just to see how much is being communicated visually. And also, as part of my private viewing curriculum, I try to acquaint myself or reacquaint myself with some of the great achievements of the silent film era. Now, some of you may say, hold on here. What if you're directing a show and you're handed a scene that's just inherently not visual? For instance, two people talking on the telephone. Well, hold that thought. The fourth directorial reminder is one I wish more directors would consider, namely, can you use body language to tell your story? How can your actors physicalize the emotional content? For instance, can we understand the gist of a scene just by watching a character's hand or their back? Let's take a look at a couple of clips that illustrate, frankly, just how expressive a hand or back can be. The first clip is from the World War I drama, All Quiet on the Western Front. It was directed by Lewis Milestone in 1930. That would be 90 years ago. Here's the setup for the clip. A German soldier spots a butterfly outside of his trench. He reaches for it, and in the process inadvertently gives away his position, and a sniper kills him. Let's watch how Milestone stages this action. And give me a second to cue this up. Thank you. I love this scene, by the way. So what I love about it, the hand inches, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't stop sharing for a second. Hold on, there we are. The hand inches towards the butterfly, recoils from the gunshot and droops to the mud. There's no close-up of the character's face. Body language does all the work. I want to show you another example. This one from a World War II drama that I have a hunch a lot of you have seen, Saving Private Ryan, directed by Steven Spielberg. Here's the setup for this clip. An army chaplain is en route to the Ryan home to deliver the heartbreaking news that another one of the Ryan boys has been killed in action. So let's take a look at this one. I'm getting pretty good at this share screen stuff. Hold on a second. Here we are. So what's amazing to me is that Spielberg keeps the camera behind Mrs. Ryan as she awkwardly collapses to the floorboards. And so at the emotional peak of the scene, there's no close-up of the character we're most invested in. And I would argue actually that the actor's physicality is more powerful than any close-up might have been. Before we go on, I want to circle back to this idea I mentioned earlier about being attentive to all the actors, no matter how big or small their role is. In this scene, the chaplain gets out of the car and sits next to Mrs. Ryan. That's basically the sum total of his role in the entire film. But a good director will give that actor a note to help him create the inner life of that chaplain. For instance, if I was directing the scene, I might ask the actor, how many times this morning has this chaplain been required to deliver such terrible news? Or how does this particular chaplain console a grieving parent? And again, the scene doesn't even include the action of the chaplain consoling Mrs. Ryan, but asking the actor what the character might do helps him create, again, that sense of inner life that I promise an audience will definitely feel. The fifth item on our directorial checklist is simply shot selection itself. We could talk about shot selection all afternoon, but I just want to throw a few questions at you. These are the kinds of questions I ask myself when pre-visualizing a scene. Is there an overall visual concept for the film or series? Let's go back to The Office for a second. The Office has a distinct visual concept. It's a fake documentary. Every shot choice should reinforce the illusion that there's a documentary crew catching, you know, by chance the day-to-day lives of the paper company employees. I helped set the style of the show, the visual style of the show. Among other things, I wanted viewers to feel that the documentary team documentary team, was unaware of what was about to happen at any given moment. And with that in mind, I might begin a scene with the camera aimed in the, quote, wrong direction, forcing the camera operators to scramble to find the action as it unfolds. More questions about shot selection include, are you using the same visual approach in every scene? Well, by the way, that's not necessarily a bad thing. There are films like Harold Ramis's Groundhog Day, for instance, in which repetition of shots is critical to telling the story. And there are films like Stanley Kubrick's Full Metal Jacket, his Vietnam War film, the first half of which is, you know, focuses on basic training, and visual repetition really helps convey the monotony and tedium of basic training. Here's one last question. In a simple dialogue scene, should the characters be the same size? So I'll be a character in a shot here. So if I'm character A, and you shoot me in close up, should character B be the same size? Should our image sizes be balanced? A lot of people feel that that is the, quote, proper way to shoot a dialogue scene, but, well, why? And again, we'll return to this question when we get to Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants. My sixth directorial reminder is try to use color and light to tell your story. Again, a subject we could spend a lot of time on. Let me give you a recent example of a director using color temperature specifically, as a storytelling tool. I have a hunch a lot of you saw the recent adaptation of Louisa May Alcott's Little Women, directed by Greta Gerwig. That director and her screenwriters took a story that was originally told in chronological order and mixed it up and created this fractured time sequence, shifting back and forth over a span of at least a decade. And often there are back-to-back scenes featuring the same actors, but at different points in time. And to keep the viewer oriented, Gerwig uses color temperature, that is, you know, what are the color values? Are they warm or cool? To let us know where we are in the time sequence. It's like super simple and hugely effective. We are never unsure of our place in Gerwig's story. That's an example of using color just for clarity's sake, but color and light can also convey the subtext of a scene or even a theme of a film. So what I want to do, I want to show you a clip from a fantastic film, Bernardo Bertolucci's film from the early 70s, The Conformist. In this clip, we meet an Italian couple. They're discussing their upcoming wedding and honeymoon. The honeymoon's going to take place in Paris. What we'll later learn in the film is that the husband-to-be has an ulterior motive for wanting to honeymoon in Paris. Namely, he's part of a plot to assassinate an Italian emigre living there. So let's take a peek at this.
Marcello, non li dai a me? Oggi ho un folle bisogno dei tuoi fiori, sai?
Da qua. Per te.
Ah, sai che ho pensato? Devo andare da una chiromante. Voglio sapere tutto di te. Ma cosa fai lì? Amore.
Attento.
Marcello, ma siamo fidanzati, che c'è di male? Sai che mi ha portato mio zio dall'America?
Cosa?
Mamma ha fatto la Tati, vuoi vederla?
No, mi fido.
Sai che ha detto Donna Tanzi? Se vuoi sposarti devi comunicarti e se vuoi comunicarti devi confessarti, se no lui non ci sposa.
Ma io non sono credente.
Ah? E chi lo è? Il 90% della gente che va in chiesa mica è credente. E i preti stessi?
E va bene, se ti fa piacere mi vado a confessare.
Ti amo. Se tu volessi.
Se io volessi.
Anche subito. Qui per terra, sul tappeto. Vuoi?
Pensiamo prima al prete. E se lui poi non mi assolve?
Assolvono tutti, sempre. In fondo manca così poco. Hai pensato al viaggio di nozze?
Certo. Ma non posso ancora dire niente. È una sorpresa.
The combination of the patterns cast by the Venetian blinds and her striped dress creates this riot of crisscrossing lines. And for me, it suggests that these two characters are prisoners. What? But prisoners of what? Middle class conformity? Well, I'm not sure, but the title of the film, The Conformist, certainly offers a clue. My seventh reminder is a concept that comes from literary criticism called the objective correlative. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail about the origin of this phrase. I get into its history in my book, but here's what I'll ask. Can a prop convey the emotional subtext of a scene? Can a piece of wardrobe represent an entire character's arc? For you Breaking Bad fans, think of how Walter White's pork pie hat actually reflects his character's trajectory. Can furniture tell a story? Let's go back to The Office once again and look specifically at the key relationship between Pam and Jim. As the director of the pilot, part of my job was to figure out the layout of the Dunder Mifflin bullpen. Should the bullpen have an open plan or should everyone work in cubicles? How should the characters relate in the space? Now, from the get-go, Pam and Jim's story is fraught with tension. They are clearly attracted to each other, but she has a boyfriend, and over the course of the second season, I guess, she becomes engaged. So can their desk arrangement help tell that story? Can the way their chairs interact create an objective correlative of the tension between them? A few months ago in the summer, I was a guest on a podcast. Some of you Office fans may know it. The podcast is called Office Ladies. It's hosted by Jenna Fisher, who plays Pam, and Angela Kinsey, who plays the accountant, Angela. And what I want to do, I want to show you a clip. It's a visual, a clip from the podcast, and the subject is Pam and Jim's desks. Let me make this a little bigger.
I do remember spending a lot of time thinking about the relationship between Pam's chair and Jim's chair. I mean, Pam's, your reception area was always where it was, but it was a question of where would Jim sit? And it seems now like, how could it not be what it was? But I love the idea that you always look at Jim and Jim has to turn to look at you. It's like the simplest thing, but I thought that somehow the way your desks related would help tell the Pam-Jim story. Nothing makes me happier than some of the shots we did where like John's in profile in the foreground and you're in the background, Jenna, like gazing at him, and he either is unaware that you're looking at him or he's completely pretending to be unaware and he knows yes. very well that you're looking at him. So I could feel like that was actually something that was like a key moment in setting up the Dunder Mifflin world.
So just to repeat myself, the desk arrangement creates an objective correlative of the relationship. And again, I'm going to repeat what I said in the podcast. It enabled me to create a signature image for the series as a whole. So as aspiring directors, I really urge you to start thinking about how a prop or a piece of wardrobe or even the space itself can reinforce the subtext of your story. My eighth directorial tip, and again, this is one that not many people think about, but I love thinking about this, is can you use off-screen space to tell your story? I mean, it's for me, it's as important to manipulate what's outside of the frame as it is to choreograph what's contained within it. And often what we don't see is more compelling or funnier than what we actually do see. Here's an example from Mike Nichols's film, The Graduate. The main character, Benjamin, is having an affair with a married woman, Mrs. Robinson. I don't recall if she even has a first name in the story. They just keep calling her Mrs. Robinson. The two often rendezvous at a hotel for an afternoon tryst. And in this very simple scene, Benjamin lies in bed watching TV while Mrs. Robinson gets dressed to leave. By the way, that's probably all the scene description said. It, you know, quote, Benjamin watches TV while Mrs. Robinson gets dressed. But look how Mike Nichols choreographs this simple action. And by the way, this isn't something he came up with on the day. This shot was carefully planned in advance. And before we look at the clip, I want to show you the storyboards, the original storyboards from the scene. Drawn by the great Harold Michelson. So the first shot, number 74, as you can see, it's just seems to be an insert of the TV with what seems like a test pattern. But then we see Benjamin lying in bed. There's a small square within the square, or I should say rectangle within the rectangle, suggesting that maybe this shot will begin with a closer view of Benjamin and zoom out. And then of course, a mostly naked Mrs. Robinson moves right to left. And as she reappears, each time she reappears, she is progressively more dressed until finally she leaves and the camera pans with her to the door. Let's watch the clip.
Streams are ripe and swelled with rain. May she will stay, resting in my arms again.
I love how faithfully Mike Nichols replicated the storyboards. But again, what's amazing about that shot to me is the fact that what's of most interest is off camera. Finally, our ninth item on our checklist is to be mindful of transitions from one scene to the next. And I would argue that most transitions in films and TV are pretty flabby, not very interesting. I mean, how many times have we watched a restaurant scene that begins with a waiter carrying a tray and the camera pans with the tray and until it lands on our characters, our main characters sitting at a table? It's super dull and I'm guilty of having done it many times. What I wanna do, I wanna show you a very famous transition. This is from Stanley Kubrick's film, 2001, A Space Odyssey. And here's what we will see. We watch a prehistoric primate. A prehistoric primate tosses a bone into the air, at which point the director, Stanley Kubrick, cuts to a new scene several thousand years later featuring a spaceship circling the Earth. Now, before we get to the transition, let me set up the scene. This particular primate has just made an earth-shattering discovery, namely that he can use a bone as a weapon. And this discovery leads to the scene we're about to watch, a scene that might be called the birth of violence. So let's watch it. So a couple of things about this very iconic transition. The first thing is pre-planning. There's nothing accidental about this transition. They didn't come up with it, you know, on the day. The actor in the prehistoric primate suit didn't just suddenly impetuously throw the bone into the air. The transition wasn't found in the cutting room. It was meticulously planned. And the second thing I want to point out is this. Okay, here's my glasses case. My glasses case kind of occupies about the same amount of space in this frame as that bone and that spaceship occupy. And yet, talk about a contrast in image size, a close-up of a bone to a crazy wide shot of a spaceship. So for me, the second important thing is contrast. I mean, contrast creates energy, period. And I would just, as a aspiring director, I would just write the word contrast on a post-it and keep it in front of you at all times. Contrast, as a visual storyteller, contrast is your friend. So the bottom line, here's what a well-designed transition does for an audience. It makes the viewer feel comfortable that someone is in charge of the storytelling, that someone capable is at the wheel of the vehicle, of the narrative vehicle. Those are my 9 tips. Now I want to switch gears and show you a scene I directed from the Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants. I chose this scene from Sisterhood for 2 reasons. One, it's an emotionally powerful scene. And second, the action of the scene, at least on the surface, is very mundane. It's a phone conversation, 2 people on the phone. Here's the setup. The character Carmen, played by America Ferrara, has been looking forward to spending her summer holiday with her divorced father, Al, played by Bradley Whitford. Upon arriving at his new home, however, Carmen is startled to find out that Al is now living with his new fiance, Lydia. And on top of that, Lydia has several children of her own. Needless to say, it's a total gut punch. Her father should have prepared her for this. And Carmen's much anticipated holiday soon goes off the rails and she unceremoniously returns home. Her best friend, Tibby, played by Amber Tamblyn, urges Carmen to get up the nerve to confront her father on the phone. And that's what this scene is. So let's watch it.
Hello?
Dad? It's Carmen.
I'm glad you called. It's all right. You don't have to apologize, sweetheart. You were upset. I know.
No, Dad, you don't know. That's just it. You've never known. Because I've never been able to tell you.
Told me what?
That I'm angry with you, Dad. This entire thing about you and Lydia and the kids.
It's my fault. I should have told you about them before, and I'm sorry.
Yeah, you should have warned me, but it's more than that. It's the fact that you found yourself this new family. And I feel like some outsider who doesn't even belong to you anymore. It's like you traded me and Mom in for something that you thought was better. And I want to know why. Are you ashamed of me? Are you embarrassed? Just tell me, Dad, what did I do wrong? Why did you leave? Why did you have to go? And then tell me that we were going to be closer, but that never happened. Then why does Paul visit his alcoholic dad every month? Did you only visit me twice a year? And I know you just seem so happy about being Paul and Kristen's dad, but you never even had the time to be mine.
I'm sorry. I'm so sorry.
I wish that were enough, Dad.
So clearly, you know, it's America's performance that gives the scene its emotional charge. But what I want to talk about is all the craft choices that I made that support the emotional content of the scene. I'm going to circle back through our checklist, starting with color and light. And again, the focus is contrast. The phone call takes place in two kitchens. And I wanted to create as much contrast between the kitchens as possible. Al and Lydia's kitchen is white. You might say it represents Al's new white bread suburban family. It's clean and uncluttered, which perfectly reflects Al's character. He's a conflict-averse guy. Emotions are messy. Better to keep them at arm's length. And the kitchen is appropriately spotless. By contrast, Carmen's kitchen has orange walls. There are splashes of color everywhere. It perfectly represents Carmen's vibrant personality. And simply by intercutting these contrasting spaces, you create, as I said before, cinematic energy. Here's a small, fascinating detail. I told my cinematographer, John Bailey, that when we got to Bradley's close shot, I said, I want everything in the frame to be white. And when I arrived to review the shot, I was surprised to find a bowl of lemons on the table. I said to John, we talked about this. I wanted everything in the kitchen to be white. And he replied, yes, that's exactly why the lemons are there. It's a burst of yellow that actually enables the eye to perceive everything else as white. So let's talk about body language. This is a talky scene, but I wanted physicality to play a role. Al starts the scene on his feet. He and Lydia are conferring with a wedding planner. Carmen starts the scene sitting. So he's the parent, she's the child. But as she takes him to task, the power dynamic changes. As she stands up for herself, he sits down. And I plan the cut so that the moment America rises, Bradley takes a seat. It's a small but significant craft choice that physicalizes the power shift between the characters. Here's another simple but potent body language choice. I asked Bradley to cover his face with his hand as the scene progressed. Al is ashamed. And I wanted to create a sense that he was actually sort of hiding his shame from the audience. So he spends most of the scene, you know, like this with his hand tensely draped over his cheek. Now let's talk about shot selection. I asked earlier, if two people are engaged in a conversation, their character one, character two, do they need to have the same image size? Well, the answer is absolutely not. In addition to asking Bradley to cover his face, I chose not to shoot any conventional frontal angle on him at all. He is only seen in profile, his face completely obscured. Conversely, I wanted to visually reinforce the sense of Carmen like unloading her emotions, unloading her feelings. So I framed her in an uncomfortably tight close-up. I wanted the viewer to almost feel trapped by her outpouring of emotion. Now, by the way, Amber Tamplin has no dialogue in the scene, but her presence is critical. It's as if she's there, she's got Carmen's back. She's like a sentry, you know, protecting Carmen as her friend confronts her dad. Amber never moves. She never even looks at Carmen once the phone conversation begins. My original thought, by the way, was to have Tibby, that's Amber's character, to have Tibby exit, effectively giving Carmen the floor. But on the shooting day, it seemed more powerful for Tibby to remain in the background, you know, guarding the emotional perimeter. But what I did do toward the end of the scene is I asked America to make a move. She moves from right to left, and we pan with her, we pan with Carmen, effectively excluding Tibby from the frame. Now Carmen is alone in the shot. And it's as if the shot is saying she doesn't need any backup. She's got this. Let's talk about transitions. This scene does not have an interesting visual transition, to be honest. I shot an insert of the cordless phone sitting on the table as Tibby pushes it toward Carmen. I remember my thought was, well, maybe it'll create a little moment of mystery. Where are we? Why are we looking at this phone? But in cutting the film together, it seemed a lot better to start with Carmen's apprehensive face, followed by a shot of Tibby sliding that phone. I do remember, by the way, telling Amber that she should slide the phone as if making a critical chess move. And in post-production, we actually enhanced the sound of the phone, creating a little hint of foreboding. So finally, let's go back to the two first items on our checklist, the emotional roadmap and playable notes. America and I, in rehearsal, discussed Carmen's overall journey at great length. She loves her father, misses him desperately, and is determined to enjoy a wonderful bonding summer with him. But he totally foils her plans. And in this scene, Carmen has a very specific goal. Her goal is to be acknowledged. Believe it or not, America did over 10, 12, many, many takes of this scene. She had this inexhaustible reservoir of energy. And from take to take, I gave her different tactics to achieve her goal. I would say, reason with your father, or in a different take, attack your father, demand that he acknowledge you, coax him into acknowledging you. I also suggested that at any moment she should switch tactics. I remember telling her, start by reasoning with your dad. But the moment Al says, you don't have to apologize, you realize how clueless he is. And in that moment, you decide to destroy him. So I also reminded her, by the way, of the risks involved in being so honest. He needs to know how angry you are, I told America, but you're afraid that your anger may drive him away forever. So these were notes that America could play, and each take gave America a chance to try a different line of attack. In my mind, by the way, we weren't aiming for any definitive version of the scene. My goal was to simply give America notes that would keep her in an exploratory mode. I wanna tell you a story now. This is an interesting sidebar. Every take was emotional. And at one point, one of my producers pulled me aside, worried. My producer was worried that America's acting was, quote, over the top. And there's an old adage that my producer reminded me, that if a character doesn't cry, the audience will. So that's what my producer told me. And at that moment, I thought, oh my God, this is the most singularly unhelpful suggestion. We kept shooting, and I couldn't rein in America's intensity. It seemed 1,000% honest. I mean, this scene is a major catharsis for this character. And I felt that pulling back the floodgates was kind of a chicken shit move. So we shot the scene, we shot the film. Months later, we previewed the film. We had a packed house full of mostly young women. And when this scene began, it was a white knuckle moment for me. And as Carmen let loose this torrent of emotion, there were two girls in the audience to my left. I remember exactly where they were. They started laughing. And my producer's warning came back to me in a flash, and I was terrified that the laughter would spread. But another moment passed, and two other girls in another part of the theater yelled, "Shut up!" And I'm happy to say the laughing girls did shut up, and the audience continued its rapt engagement with the scene. So I guess if there's a moral to that story, it's this: if an honest emotion unsettles your audience, you're probably doing something right as a director. So with that in mind, I want to show you the scene one last time, and I want you to see how I applied my checklist. Here we go.
Glad you called. It's all right. You don't have to apologize, sweetheart. You were upset. I know.
No, Dad, you don't know. That's just it. You've never known. Because I've never been able to tell you.
Told me what?
That I'm angry with you, Dad. This entire thing about you and Lydia and the kids.
It's my fault. I should have told you about them before, and I'm sorry.
Yeah, you should have warned me, but it's more than that. It's the fact that you found yourself this new family. And I feel like some outsider who doesn't even belong to you anymore. It's like you traded me and Mom in for something that you thought was better. And I want to know why. Are you ashamed of me? Are you embarrassed? Just tell me, Dad, what did I do wrong? Why did you leave? Why did you have to go? And then tell me that we were going to be closer, but that never happened. Then why does Paul visit his alcoholic dad every month? But you only visit me twice a year. And I know you just seem so happy about being Paul and Kristen's dad. But you never even had the time to be mine.
I'm sorry. I'm so sorry.
I wish that were enough, Dad.
So the reason again for choosing this scene was that on the surface, it seems like a very uncinematic scene. And it may be the kind of scene that you as a director will be handed someday to shoot. But my feeling is that once you grasp the emotional content, that you can use an array of tools, in this case, color, contrasting color, body language, choreography, contrasting image size to really bolster that emotional content. And that's what I have to say about the director's craft today. I'm so happy to get to share this with you and would love to answer any and all questions you might have about this or anything. I can't comment on anything, but some things.
Hey, Ken. So, Peter, I are going to rejoin you. One question that's going to be on everybody's mind, so let's get this out of the way. What's the name of your dog?
Oh, that is my beloved dog, Spy. I'm sorry to say he's no longer with us, but I cannot take him off my desktop yet. So, an English lab. An English lab.
I'm glad that we resolved that question.
I'm going to say that's it.
A lot of people were going to be done here now. Curious about that. Before we get into the real questions, we have a couple of media members who want to say hi. Lynn Venhouse, whose name you might recognize.
Absolutely.
She says, I have known Ken since grade school. Just wanted to say hi and enjoyed his appearance on KTRS Thursday. And she also wanted to compliment Pete for the great job he does at Webster U Film Series. Kathleen Stanger-Kaiser also says, hello, Ken. It was wonderful interviewing this morning on the She Said, He Said show on AM 990 The Fan. So excited to hear your masterclass this afternoon too. All right, so those are the initial comments, and now let's get into the actual questions. Let's start with Lynn, since she already weighed in once. This is a very specific question. She wants to know what it was like to direct Robert Redford and Nick Nolte in their quote unquote golden years.
Oh my gosh. Well, I mean, the one of the challenges with Redford, of course, is that you're directing a director. I mean, not only is he an actor, a movie star, an iconic figure in American filmmaking, but he's a director. He's a director who, right out of the gate, his first film as a director won him an Academy Award. So I will say the good news is that right from the start, Redford told me, he said, I'm going to take off all those hats. I'm taking off my producer's hat. I'm taking off my director's hat. I just want to be the actor. I just want to focus on that. And he really enjoyed my direction. And specifically, it's, you know, Redford is, you know, he's so good, but he's not somebody you think of necessarily for lighter roles. I mean, you think of him, you know, in All the President's Men. I mean, obviously, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid has a lot of humor in it, but I would say by and large, you don't think of Redford as, you know, again, gravitating towards lighter roles. This is a lighter role, and I think he really appreciated me sort of helping guide him, you know, to do some things that were, you know, more comedic than he's used to doing.
Dylan Allen wants to know how you approach directing separate genres differently.
Separate genres? That's a great question. Well, here's what I would say. I don't know about genres, but let me just talk about the difference between comedy and drama for a second. What I like to do, I mean, I don't like to think of myself as either a comedy or drama director. I'm a storyteller. So what I often do is if I'm working on something that is comedic, I will take a look at the scene, take a look at the material, and what my task is to figure out how to ground that comedic material in emotional reality, to make sure it's grounded, to make sure it's not simply a lot of witty banter, but that it actually has some, you know, emotional oomph. On the flip side is if I'm working on a piece of dramatic material, sometimes I will try to find the humor that's hiding in the drama. And so that I'm convinced there's always humor hiding in the drama somewhere. And I think it just takes a good director to, you know, suss it out.
Dylan has a follow-up question, but before I get to it, I want to mention the fact, and I'm sure Chris has shared this already, but just in case, if you want more information about Ken's book, you can go to the website. But What I Really Want to Do is Direct, but What I Really Want to Do is Direct, altogether.com, hashtag new hyphen release. So, and again, you can obviously search for it in other ways. And I would encourage you, of course, to perhaps patronize your local independent bookstore in order to secure yourself a copy. All right, now Dylan's other question. What's one thing directors can do every day to sharpen their craft?
Wow. Well, here's every day. That's tricky. Well, here's what I would say. I do feel like to be a good director, you need to be a good student of human nature. So I would actually, as a daily exercise, just to start to, you know, kind of be observant of people and their behavior and start to be a bit of a detective when it comes to why people behave the way they do. Because I think that is a lot of good storytelling, is just having a sense of, again, why, how people tick, what drives them, what are their needs. And so I just feel like maybe as an exercise, think about understanding people's behavior.
Cindy Fimmel wants to know if you share the storyboards with the actors only or only the tech crew.
No, I don't think the actors should ever look at storyboards. And I think, again, the actor's job is to sort of create the inner life of the story. And the storyboard is obviously to create images. The purpose of the boards is to communicate to your cinematographer. And often you actually draw the board or create the boards in conjunction with your cinematographer. So I don't feel like shot list or storyboards are to be shared with the cast.
Jillian Barnes, who is herself a wonderful actress and who is also the chair of Cinema St. Louis, says, love that you share the importance of the tiniest role. It's in the details. How do you instill the quote unquote overall style feel of the film to someone who is only on the set for one day or less? Often the actors are not privy to the entire script.
Well, I think that, hopefully the act, if you have one scene in a picture or one scene in a episode of a series, you will get a sense of the tone pretty quickly from how you interact with the other actors. I would say that, I don't think I've ever simply tried to describe the tone of something to an actor as much as just sort of give them notes that guide them to a place tonally that makes sense. So I don't think, again, I feel like to have an intellectual discussion about the tone of a film is a great thing to do, but not with the actors. That's not their job.
Yeah. Kathy Kaiser wants to know, when you initially view a screenplay, do you instantly start conceptualizing each scene in sequence, or do you find yourself focused on a particular part of the storyline to begin with and then evolve the film from that one scene?
Here's the process for me, and for me, especially if it's, say, a project I'm debating whether to pursue, I read the script and figure out if I can make a real human emotional connection to the characters. And I'll just talk about one film I directed. The film He's Just Not That Into You has 9 characters in it. So there's a lot of storylines to juggle. But happily, when I read the script, I felt like I could make a very personal connection to each of the 9 characters. And literally, I felt like, well, whether it was Jennifer Connelly's character or Scarlett Johansson's character or Justin Long's character, I could kind of trace a line from that story back to something I've done in my own personal life. So that's the main thing, is I felt very confident that I could make each of those 9 characters and their storylines compelling, because I feel like I've been there, done that, so.
Jill Hamilton says, great list, thank you so much for sharing, but she wants a little reminder as to what were number 2 and 3. I will tell you, Jill, you need to buy the book, but we'll let Ken go ahead and share that number two
is to create playable notes for your actors. So that was, what I discussed in, for instance, giving America certain tactics to achieve her goal in that scene. And number 3 is simply a very general idea, but it's the big one. Tell your story with pictures. Try to think about whether you can convey information without dialogue. You're always going to have dialogue. That's not an issue. But how much can you convey without it?
Gabe Sheets asks, do you have any general advice for working with a production designer and or costume designer to help tell the story? Are you incredibly specific, or is it a situation where you want to hire good people and then get out of their way?
Well, obviously every director is different, but here's what I feel. For instance, I'll just talk about costume design. Costume design is not my forte. I feel like I'm trying with every new picture and job, trying to learn a little bit more about it. But what I do feel as the director, my authority is the emotional content of the story. My authority in any dialogue with, whether it's the designer or the costume designer or the production designer, is what's going on in the lives of these characters. I would much rather have the designers get excited by that and translate it into imagery than for me to simply tell them what the images they should come up with.
Amy notes that this is so amazing. Thank you. I suspect a lot of people are thinking that. Jill Hamilton asks, as a director, which tasks do you enjoy but think it better to delegate? Conversely, which tasks do you not enjoy but are unwilling to delegate?
Wow. Those are like two trick questions.
The first one, which tasks do you enjoy but you think it's better that you delegate them to others?
Oh, okay. Well, this is going back to Pete, what your question was too. I feel very confident that I can pre-visualize a scene. I feel very confident that I can come up with wonderful images. And part of it is I've just, you know, I feel like I have a storehouse of wonderful images from films and television shows floating around in my head. But I think it's more important to not impose those ideas on the DP, because I'm actually, I feel like what I really like to do as a director is encourage everyone to own, to have a sense of ownership about the process. So I love the idea, again, of sort of talking to the DP using emotional terms about the characters and their journeys, and letting the DP sort of take it and run with it from there. So that's one I would delegate. Now, the other one was,
what? Conversely, which tasks do you not enjoy, but you feel it's imperative that you actually hold on to those and do them yourself?
Oh, wow. What don't I enjoy? I mean, I really do like most parts of the process. I mean, I will say that I'm going to come back to that question. I don't have a good answer for that one. I mean, there are some things that I'm always, that I feel like I'm more skilled at than others, but I don't know. I'm going to come back to that. Let me think on that one.
Well, while you're thinking, I've got one from Jessica Ambule. Apologies, Jessica, if I mispronounced your last name. One of the best masterclasses I've attended over the years. Ken provided a beautifully organized and informational session with practical steps to improve a director's skills and enhance their passion for storytelling at any stage of their career. So I guess that was just a nice comment. I'm sorry. So next is Kara Day. Do you ever purposefully misdirect to elicit a particular reaction?
Misdirect, I assume, meaning the actors.
I would assume so, yeah.
There's a lot of different ways to misdirect. I don't know that I'm not sure about that. I mean, let me think about misdirection for a second. I think that I often try and create like visual misdirects. I mean, I mentioned one in a way talking about the style of the show, The Office, the idea that the camera is actually looking in the exact wrong place for the scene we're about to see. And so that the camera has to, you know, kind of scramble and find the action. That would be an example of a visual misdirect. I don't manipulate the actors, if that's what misdirect means. I do try as a storyteller to find ways to throw you off the scent a little bit. So. And again, that's just one example from The Office.
Brian Clinton asks, how difficult was it directing the Larry Sanders Show?
I would say that Larry Sanders was a very complicated show from a technical standpoint, first of all. It was complicated on every level, but it's a show in which, you know, the scenes backstage were all shot on 16 millimeter, whereas the talk show within the show, the quote Larry Sanders Show, was taped. And so there was it was just a lot of different formats to juggle. And in addition, when we started the show, you know, our goal was to get real people to play themselves, but nobody knew what the show was. So it was actually very, and I all felt it, poor Gary. I mean, Gary had to like enlist everyone he knew to try, you know, to come aboard and play themselves. But at the beginning, the show had not been on the air. It didn't have any, profile of any kind. So people were constantly bailing on us at the last minute. So there were just a lot of logistical challenges.
Brian Clinton has another question. My 16-year-old son, Miles, is interested in film. Besides the obvious advice of watching a lot of films and going to film school, do you have any advice for a young film lover?
Well, I mean, I would say this is not a piece of advice per se, but if a young person is passionate about it, they'll know. And if they are passionate, they'll do it. So I'm actually very encouraging. I know some people can be very discouraging about this industry or this business or this field of endeavor. I'm not at all. I feel like if you feel it, if you're really passionate, passion will win the day. And the only thing I would say to a young person is, as a potential storyteller, not only a director, but let's say a writer and director, tell your story. Tell your story. Don't tell somebody else's story. Start with yourself. You are your best resource. And I would say nothing makes a buyer or a producer or a studio executive sit up and take notice more than when someone comes into the room and says, this is my story. I have to tell this story. It's mine. So, I mean, again, keep it personal.
As a follow-up to that, one of the things he was asking is whether or not it would be a wise idea for the person to go to school. You obviously attended Northwestern as an undergrad and then went on to USC, although you didn't quite get your master's because you got hired to direct something before finishing. So obviously you put value in that education, and perhaps access to equipment was one thing that helps obviously when you go to school. But how important is it to actually just do it, particularly in today's environment? When you went to school, it was much more difficult to make a film on your own. Mm-hmm. Whereas now that's not necessarily an impediment. So talk just a little bit about how important it is to actually get working to actually produce something that you are personally connected to.
I think that, I mean, here's the good news is that, if you have a phone, you can make a groundbreaking film, period, the end. That's all you need, a phone. And it takes a lot of ingenuity to figure out how to use a phone to tell a good story, but it can be done. And that's very different than when I was starting out as a filmmaker. There, I could do the pros and cons of film school for an hour or so, but let me give you one of the major pros. And that is, regardless of where you go, whether it's a school in New York or a school in Boise, the real thing is you're going to meet other passionate film people. You're going to create. You're going to be part of a community of creative people. So I would say that one of the biggest arguments for going to school to study film is just getting to be part of a community of like-minded, cinephiles and filmmakers. I hope that answers the question, but that's there's much more to discuss about that, the pros and cons.
Yeah, Jill Hamilton wanted to just say thanks for the heads up about the book. The next question is from Gabe Sheets. Gabe Sheets wants to know, during the All Quiet on the Western Front clip, when the soldier first sees the butterfly, we cut to a close-up of a tight eye line. This seems to create an intimacy between the audience and the character. When is this technique most effective and when might it be overused?
It's a great question. I mean, I would say that, I would say that the tight eye line can do a couple of things. It can sort of, it can sort of create a sense of intimacy. It can also kind of weird you out a little bit. So if a character, I'm going to look straight into this lens for a second. So if I'm staring right into the lens, I mean, for an audience, that can actually create a sense of being almost like it's too much. So, I think the tight eye line itself can be applied to achieve different things. It's also in combination with image size. So the shot of that soldier is not so close. I mean, he's sort of framed, as I recall, by the little trench window, as opposed to say America Ferrara in that sisterhood scene where I'm gonna be America now, she really fills that frame. So again, and she never has a tight eye line to the lens. So that's an example of, there's no tight eye line. She's either like that or like that, but but I would say it certainly feels intimate to me. So again, tight eye line is just one of many ways that you can create a sense of intimacy with a character.
Just a little curiosity on my own part. When you were talking about transitions, mm-hmm. It occurred to me that too can be overuse in certain films where you're always trying to come up with some sort of clever match cut. One film that I don't want to in any way besmirch the reputation of Danny DeVito, because I love The War of the Roses, but I remember in Hoffa, virtually every time we transist between scenes, he's got some sort of very clever match cut. And at a certain point, it almost becomes wearying. It's like, oh, what's he going to do now in order to move us out of that scene into the next?
I would say that here's my answer to that. I think you're 100% right. I think that it's, I think in that case, and I know the film, I mean, I think in that case, he just sort of went to the same, you know, he used that play. He went to the well too many times, you know, in terms of that kind of transition. A great transition, by the way, doesn't have to be a pair of linked shots. And I talk about this in the book, and I'll just mention one that many of you will know. In the film Jaws, there's a wonderful transition. It's the transition which starts the adventure to find the shark. You see the boat heading out to sea, but what you do is you see the boat framed by a set of shark's teeth that is sitting on the desk of the shark hunter's office. So again, it's not a pair of shots, so there's no clever cut, but it's sort of a wonderfully witty image that stands on its own. And again, it's both witty and creates a sense of anticipation and foreboding. Again, it's a single shot, so I just wanted to add that into the mix.
Kathy Kaiser wants to know, do you feel that any director of the past has influenced your style and how you direct your own films or series?
Wow, I mean, a lot. I mean, I would say that's such a great question because so many people have influenced me and I think about so many different kinds of directors. I certainly have been influenced by people like Orson Welles and William Wyler, just thinking about how they stage action and both, not only how they stage action, but how they get such wonderful performances from people. And I also am, as I write about in the book, a huge fan of Ernst Lubitsch. A lot of the reason I'm a fan of Ernst Lubitsch is because of his sense of, you know, trying to visualize things in unexpected ways, but also the way he sort of creates, I mean, some of his greatest films are quote comedic, but they don't really feel that way. The Shop Around the Corner, I guess you'd call it a comedy, but it just feels like a very human story that happens to have a lot of great humor in it. So he has a real gift for, talk about a student of human nature. He has a real gift for understanding the human condition. So
I believe one of your favorites is also Buster Keaton from the silent era.
I would say that Buster Keaton, I mean, I almost showed a clip today of Keaton to illustrate the idea of off-screen space. I mean, I would say that Keaton is so critical for understanding just visual comedy and particularly I'll call it the geometry of comedy. I mean, there's so many things about Keaton's work that are geometric and very modern in that sense. And he also is somebody who occasionally does amazing things with off-screen space. And I'll just mention one thing where there's a wonderful short of his called One Week. And at the climax of the short, there's a house that Keaton and his bride are sort of transporting across a railroad track. And it gets stuck on the tracks. Well, of course, down the road comes a train, and you're absolutely convinced that train's going to hit the house. Well, in fact, it passes right behind the house, and goes away. And Keaton and his bride are like thrilled. Almost immediately, though, another train comes right into the from the opposite side of the frame and demolishes the house. Off-screen space. Watch this short, One Week. It's such a brilliant use of off-screen space.
So. Now, related to influences, obviously there's a danger there because the notion that you love a particular shot in a film and you feel this almost compulsion, I need to replicate that. It would work so well within this film that I'm doing. How much do you indulge that and how much do you pull back and resist doing that because you don't want to just simply replicate, you want to create?
Well, I think when I was starting out as a director, I was definitely trying to, you know, kind of recreate images that I loved. And again, especially with someone like Orson Welles, where it's easy to copy him in a way because there's, you know, just sort of things that he will do in terms of using, you know, foreground and background, for instance, that are irresistible. And certainly you can see contemporary directors like Spielberg at the beginning of his career did this, you know, did a lot of the same thing. what I try to do now, again, is make sure that those kinds of images make organic or emotional sense first. If they don't, it's really not worth just trying to replicate an image. I don't really need, you know, to have someone in the audience say, oh, cool, Ken saw my favorite Orson Welles film and he recreated a shot. It's all about what's going to really reinforce the emotional content of the picture.
Cliff's colleague Chris Clark observes that he's always enjoyed all of your episodic TV efforts, such as Malcolm in the Middle and the Santa Clarita Diet. Mm-hmm. Are there any special challenges or appeals of this format, the episodic TV format?
Well, I feel I was very fortunate to be present at the creation of a number of single camera half hour shows. And single camera meaning they were not shot in front of a live audience, taped with multiple cameras, and so I feel like in the late 90s and the early aughts there was a lot more broadcast networks started to get excited about filmic half hour shows. Malcolm in the Middle is a perfect example. Malcolm in the Middle is definitely a show where I applied a lot of Buster Keaton thinking to it, by the way, because every episode called for visual comedy, sight gags, physical comedy. And I'm not even sure what the question is anymore. But the special challenge of half hour or series television, though, as a director, is that by and large, you are not the creator of the show. Sometimes you are. And sometimes you help launch the show or do the pilot. But more often than not, you will be servicing another person's vision. And often you'll be servicing in your career a wide variety of very different visions. So the creator of Malcolm in the Middle is very different than the creator of, say, The Office in terms of their sensibility. So as a director, the challenge is how to bring your personality to both. And by the way, when I say service, it sounds like, you know, how to actually, you know, sort of understand, you know, their vision and sort of, you know, it's like a poker game. Okay, I see you and I'll raise you. You know, like here's a new idea you haven't thought of, but it fits your vision of the show.
We have a couple of thanks from Jillian Barnes. Thanks so much for sharing your time and talents today. And from Dylan Allen, thank you for sharing your insights. This was wonderful. I can't wait to read the book. We'll have to make certain that he goes and buys one. Amy, do you see changes in the film industry that will be lasting after COVID times, such as smaller crews, et cetera?
Right. Well, one of the things I observed during the pandemic was that there are a lot of creative people who really focused on the challenge of how to tell stories with minimal characters. I've been on more than a few meetings with producers or studio heads where the question is, can you come up with great stories that involve two people? And happily, we can all point to various films we've seen over the years or shows that have minimal casts. I'll just mention one. A great example is Rob Reiner's film Misery with James Caan and Kathy Bates. The entire film is just those two characters, and yet it's riveting, start to finish. So again, I feel like the pandemic really prompted a lot of super creative, you know, discussions. My feeling is that I haven't directed since the pandemic began. I hope to direct in the new year, in the spring. I don't know what the protocols will be like at that time, but I would say the only thing in terms of lasting changes, my biggest concern is that my biggest concern is about movie going itself, and I'm hardly alone in fearing that people will have lost and, you know, gotten out of the habit of going to a movie theater. So my hope that is that it's not the case. And my hope it is, as things get a little safer, that people will be chomping at the bit to get back to a movie theater. But that is a little concern of mine.
Well, to a certain extent, this next question ties into that, maybe indirectly. Lynn Venhouse wants to know, how have streaming platforms changed the industry from your perspective? You've done work on network, cable TV, and studios.
Well, I would say the biggest change in terms of the streaming services is that everything, including half hour shows, are serialized narrative. For instance, you know, once upon a time, a broadcast network would make a show like Friends, and you could watch any episode in any order. but that's not the case anymore. So if you're watching a streaming service half-hour show like Fleabag or Catastrophe, you're watching a serialized narrative. That is new. That is new for comedy. That is certainly new for half-hour. I would say the great news for me as a director, especially in the half-hour format, is that, go back to the Larry Sanders Show, because I feel that the Larry Sanders Show was really a harbinger of today's more tonally challenging half-hour shows. But for me, the half-hour format is very flexible these days. I mean, there are shows like Atlanta, I'll point that out. I mean, Atlanta is so fascinating to me. I mean, is it a comedy? Sometimes it is, sometimes it's not. It really shows how, again, flexible that format is now. I worked on a show for Amazon called One Mississippi. It was created by the comic Tig Notaro, wonderful stand-up comic. And the series is very autobiographical, and it deals with very difficult subject matter. It deals with breast cancer and the molestation of children, a lot of very dire things. And yet she manages to find humor in the darkest corners. And again, it's just a testament to how free that format is these days.
Jill Hamilton asks, when bringing books to film, such as A Walk in the Woods, do you prefer to work with or not work with the author of the actual text? And you've done this on several occasions, although you didn't pen the screenplays.
Yeah, I would say that it's probably easier for both author and director to not work together. I mean, I have a feeling that the author is, I mean, I've never worked on an adaptation where the author was overseeing the script. So for instance, He's Just Not That Into You. Well, it's an advice book. It has no plot. It has no characters. And so the author of the book, again, could have written a screenplay. And in fact, I think she did do a draft, but I think the one that we ended up shooting was written by people who were not involved with the book. And I think they just had a freer hand to sort of to come up with a way to adapt an advice book of all things. So I guess my hunch, I mean, nothing against the authors. Anne Brashears, who wrote Sisterhood, I love her. I mean, Bill Bryson couldn't be sweeter, but he said, do what you gotta do. Like, you do the adaptation.
My colleague here at the Film Series has a couple of questions. Jessica Pierce wants to know, do you find it difficult to maintain balance between sticking to your vision and allowing for changes in the moment? With so many moving parts on set, I imagine you have to leave room for error, spontaneity, and compromise.
Right. Well, here's what I think here's my MO is I try to really meticulously plan things but I'm also prepared in the moment to throw out my plan completely. So I think the idea is you want a vision. You have a vision for the scene, but what you also want to do, and that's what gives you strength. I'm going to sound like a yoga instructor, because what you need is strength and flexibility. So like the strength is your pre-planning, how much you have imagined the scene, and your flexibility, of course, is getting on the set and realizing, okay, this actor has an idea I didn't think of, but you know what, it's really good, as opposed to clinging to your ideas. So part of the your job as a director, in my mind, is to keep your eyes open. Keep your eyes open for those happy accidents that are going to actually make the scene better than you originally imagined.
Well, Jessica's follow-up question you kind of addressed just now, but I'll go ahead and read it in case you have more that you want to expand on. She says, as a follow-up, many directors are meticulous about every detail within their film, whereas others are considered more on the fly and spontaneous. Where do you think you stand on that spectrum?
Well, I don't feel I'm at either extreme. I mean, I know that there are a lot of directors who are celebrated for their control, and there are certainly directors who are at least noted for, I guess, their ability to create a kind of chaotic situation. I mean, I guess I sort of think of things a little differently. I like the idea as a director of creating an atmosphere on the set where people feel loose, uninhibited. I'm talking about the cast, uninhibited, free to play, happy to go out on a limb, happy to, you know, make fools of themselves, happy to experiment. And at the same time, I also feel, you know, that it's loose, but it's not loose from a storytelling standpoint. I'm the designated storyteller, whether I'm doing an episode of Malcolm in the Middle or a feature film. So it's like, I like the idea that everyone sort of has room to play, room to kind of create, room to own their choices. And at the same time, it's my job to say, well, that choice actually does tell this story. This one doesn't, this does, this doesn't. You know. So again, it's almost like the job of a, more like an orchestrator in a way. So.
I wanted to follow up a little bit on that, Ken, because one thing that you haven't discussed in your thumbnail rules for direction is something that you talk about extensively in the book and I think is hugely important and is applicable to things beyond just directing film. And that is how you create an atmosphere on the set that's, you know, welcome and open. And you take a much kinder approach to sort of imposing your will and your vision than some other directors. So talk just a little bit philosophically how you approach working not just with cast, but also crew and just sort of creating this atmosphere on the set.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, I think that, I mean, part of what I love is the idea of creating an atmosphere where people feel like safe and acknowledged and respected. And, you know, unfortunately, you know, as a young film, you know, as a film fan and as a film student, you know, there are so many stories we hear, you know, that are enshrined in film lore about directors who are tyrants, who like work a crew to death to get some crazy shot, or who mistreat the actors. And somehow this is like held up as like, if not laudable, certainly noteworthy behavior. And I have just the opposite. That makes no sense to me. I would rather people feel like excited to work with me and excited to bring their best efforts. And so part of what I do is, and I'll give you a couple of specifics. Part of what I do is just try and set a tone that makes people not only feel welcome, but makes people really want to kind of, again, bring their A game. I mean, this is the simplest thing in the world. You have like, what, 30 people on a crew, maybe more. Well, you know, learn their names. I know it's 30 people. Well, it's a big deal. Learn their names. It's like not the hardest thing in the world to learn a bunch of people's names. And I promise, just being able to call, you know, instead of saying, actually address someone by their name changes the tenor of things in a way that's, it's so simple, but it's critical. So anyways, that's one of many things that I do to set that tone.
Jill Hamilton says that she's a huge fan of The Office and Malcolm in the Middle. Excellent work. And that leads me to a question I found myself wondering in this Q&A. So Cliff, when he was introducing you, gave a small fraction of your filmography. Your filmography is so long. Well, filmography and like the television episodes you've directed and series you've worked on and things like that. So when you meet new people, say like in a situation like this, is there one thing that they're always like, oh, I love The Office, or I love Malcolm in the Middle, or I love, or does it vary by generation? Like, what seems to be your best known and best loved work? And does it matter how much who you're talking to?
Well, I don't know that it's my job to tell you what's my best known anything. I mean, to be honest, because I feel like it's all very personal. I mean, I will meet people who say that, you know, Sesame Street presents Follow That Bird had a gigantic impact on them. Believe it or not, I've met people who've never watched The Office, I have people I meet who say that they're, you know, that the film Dunstan Checks In had a huge impact on them as a young person, or that they found, you know, so again, I wouldn't be, I it's not really my call. I mean, and again, what I'm proud of is that I feel like I've directed things that have touched people though. And a lot of different things have, you know, kind of moved people in different ways. So it's very, I mean, believe me, it's I'm very proud of that.
Dylan Allen asks, what are your thoughts on living and working in the film industry outside of LA?
Well, that's a tricky one because I've never done it. I've only worked and lived in LA. I've certainly shot in different places, but I'm based in LA. I mean, I think it's a little trickier. for a couple of reasons, and especially if you're starting out. I mean, obviously, if you are established, and many people, you know, sort of go to LA or New York, but let's just talk about LA for a second. Go to LA and sort of, you know, build a career that allows them then to choose to live elsewhere. Well, part of what you do when you're in LA, this is talking about film school too, but part of what you do in LA is you become part of a community of people who are doing the same thing. It's just a little harder to have that sense of connection with the film and television community when you're not there. And a lot of, you know, for better or for worse, it is a social business. So that a lot of the opportunities that have come my way over the years, I don't want to say it's because you're going to a party or something. It's not, I don't mean that when I say social. I just mean that it's very much about just sort of being part of a community of craftspeople and artists. So it's all doable, but it's a teeny bit harder when you're not connected to people in that way. And I don't mean to, because it can be done. It's just a little, there's extra degrees of difficulty now.
Is it a coincidence that you've worked with so many St. Louisans then? Cliff pointed out that Brian Hulfeld wrote the script for He Said, She Said. And then of course, Jenna Fisher is from St. Louis in the Office. Phyllis Smith was from St. Louis in the Office. I realize you're not casting these films or anything, but I do feel like you have a pretty deep catalog of working with St. Louisans.
Well, Brian and I we've known each other since the early 1970s. He was a high school classmate of mine and we've been friends since then. And in answer to the second part of that, I can't say I unilaterally cast anybody, but I did help cast The Office. So I actually, and in fact, if I may brag for a second, I feel quite responsible for the casting of Phyllis Smith, because I met her and thought, wow, she would be cool in this show, and convinced our showrunner to cast her. So
talk a little bit about what Phyllis's role was before you decided to cast her.
And well, Phyllis did not audition for a role in The Office. In fact, she worked with the casting director. She was the casting associate, and her job was to help with the auditions. Specifically, she would read the off-camera parts for the auditioners. So if you imagine this, I would sit next to Phyllis. We'd have a video camera filming the actors who were auditioning for the roles. And Phyllis would sit next to me and just, you know, had her nose to the text and would read the off-camera dialogue. And what I discovered over the course of our auditions, that I became more and more fascinated with Phyllis sometimes than the actors themselves. And I kept sort of like turning and watching her. And I just, I was so taken with her, and I just felt like she would be perfect as a Dunder Mifflin employee. And again, part of our job casting the show was to find people who felt real, who didn't feel like super overly glamorous. And I, again, loved, you know, Phyllis's, just as a person, her sense, her earnestness, her sincerity, her presentation, and not knowing her, I just thought, God, she really has a kind of Midwest vibe going on here. So of course I was pleased to discover once we cast her that she was a St. Louisan.
Amy asks, do you work closely with the music composer in your films? She notes, as I did when we met today on Zoom, that you're in your music room, that there are an array of guitars and a piano behind you.
I do very much. I love working with composers. I love thinking about music. I've worked with quite a few wonderful composers. I'll mention Cliff Eidelman, who I've worked with, oh my gosh, I feel like four times at least. And at the same time, on the flip side, I love scenes and films and stories that have no music. And I'll just point out one of them, and that is The Office. Apart from the little, you know, kind of theme music that plays under the opening credits, there's no music. 9 seasons. There's no musical underscore in that whole show, and no laugh track. It's completely dry in terms of its sound. But I'm very fond of working with composers, and I devote a chapter to how directors, I feel, should communicate to composers.
I should also, as a quick follow-up, allow you to talk a little bit about the fact that when you're a director, you do get to sometimes work with people that you hugely admire and bring them onto a project. I know you're a big fan of Van Dyke Parks, and you've had the opportunity to therefore work with him.
Van Dyke Parks was somebody, and if you don't know Van Dyke Parks, I encourage you to get acquainted with him. He's mainly known to people for having co-authored with Brian Wilson of the Beach Boys the infamous album Smile, which was recorded and not released for decades, this sort of legendary record. But anyways, Van Dyke is known for having done that, but he also has a career of his own as a singer, songwriter, as an orchestrator, as an incredible kind of just pop music thinker. And I had the pleasure of inviting him to work on Follow That Bird, and the score he wrote is just so kind of lush and whimsical and full of color. And again, I feel like it was, for me, getting to work with a musical hero of mine.
On that topic, yesterday, one of the regulars of the film series emailed me very enthusiastically to point out that you're working on a project about the Shags.
I am very happy to talk about the Shags. I don't have the financing yet, but I've been developing this project for years. The Shags, for those who have not heard of them, the Shags were three girls, three sisters growing up in a small town in New Hampshire who, in the late 1960s, formed a rock and roll band. Now, by the way, they didn't want to be in a band. Their father insisted that they form a band. Their father actually took them out of school and had them homeschooled, bought them some instruments, a guitar and a bass and drums, and insisted and was convinced that they would become rock and roll stars. Well, in fact, they had no musical talent whatsoever. They had no musical talent, but the father didn't understand that and raised the money to go to take the girls to Boston and record an album. And I will say without a doubt, this album, which you can buy today and listen to online, is one of the most head scratching albums ever recorded. I love it. They printed about 500 copies. Most of them were lost. In the early 1980s, I think it was Frank Zappa who unearthed one of these and found it so compelling that he helped get it reissued. I remember buying a copy when I was at USC, and I used to use it. I used to play it in my apartment in order to get people to leave because it was such an odd record, and I love it. And anyway, so the film I'm hoping to make is, I guess you'd call it a biopic about a band that I find very compelling, but a lot of people say is kind of the worst thing they've ever heard in their lives.
Is that a film that you're planning on writing as well, Ken, or do you have somebody who's writing a screenplay with you?
The author is a wonderful screenwriter named Joy Gregory, who actually authored a play about the Shags that was workshopped. I think it may have been developed in Chicago at the Looking Glass Theater. So it is technically an adaptation of a theater piece.
I will also note, since you referenced Frank Zappa as being a fan, that we are playing a terrific documentary by another former St. Louisan, Alex Winter, Zappa, on our final weekend. You can watch it on the 21st and 22nd. So I strongly encourage people. It's he had full access to the Zappa archives, which was considerable, and stuff that you've never seen or heard. Wow. And there's a lot of visual stuff that he was engaged with as well.
Wonderful.
Pete, do you want me to ask this or do you want to?
I can do it, I guess. So Lynn Venhouse, who's the film critic for the Webster Kirkwood Times. Hi, Lynn. You once told me about overhearing Creed say something that affected something. And I can't remember what it was because it was for an article in 2009. Can you share this? Because I can recall it's really funny.
Oh, well, I mean, Creed Bratton of The Office, I met Creed, and I was responsible for casting Creed in The Office, but his casting is an interesting story. I knew Creed. He was a stand-in on a different show that I worked on the Bernie Mac show. And a stand-in, for those who don't know, you're basically the proxy for the actors during the lighting process. So if I was a stand-in, you know, the actor I'm standing in for is off getting hair and makeup done while the lighting is being done. So Creed was a stand-in, and I remember one day I overheard him chatting with another stand-in talking about rock and roll, but not simply rock and roll. It was like he would say, I'd hear things like, oh yeah, backstage at the Whiskey a Go-Go, it was wild. Or, you know, oh my God, yeah, that time we opened for the Doors was great. And I thought, who is this guy? And I finally took him aside and introduced myself. I didn't know him. And he told me, I'm Creed Bratton, and told me that he was the lead guitarist of the band, The Grassroots. And this was the band in the mid-1960s that first had a hit with the song Live for Today, I think is the title. They were very much a Summer of Love kind of sounding band. And anyway, so I got to be friends with Creed. And when it came time to cast the office, Creed actually called me to ask if there was any stand-in work. And I said that we didn't have any stand-in work on the show because we were going to shoot it in this mock documentary style and do things in a little more unconventional way. And we were going to dispense with stand-ins. But I said, we have several empty desks in the Dunder Mifflin bullpen. And would he please consider, you know, working for a week in the background as an extra, just sitting at a desk with no guarantee that the show would go forward. And he said, you bet. And 9 seasons later, he, you know, became one of the most beloved characters on the show.
We're getting close to the end here, Ken. So I would like, and we have no further questions right now. So I'd like to sort of end at the beginning, in the sense that one of the things that your book does so well is, you know, you give all this practical advice for directors, but you also relate various stories, such as what the one you just told, that are also quite amusing, illuminating, and that give a taste of your own life in the biz. I want you to share how you got your first gig as a director, and the person who was very near and dear to my own heart that you ended up interviewing with.
I had an opportunity to direct an after-school special. Actually, specifically, it wasn't an after-school special. It was the CBS equivalent of the then popular after-school special. It was called the CBS Afternoon Playhouse. To get the job, I had to go to New York and meet with the executive producer of the CBS Afternoon Playhouse, a fellow by the name of Bob Keeshan. And for many of you, well, you'll know who that is immediately, but Bob Keeshan, known to millions of baby boomers by his alter ego, Captain Kangaroo. So my first job interview was with Captain Kangaroo, believe it or not. And I was nervous as all hell to meet the captain. But what I realized in the middle of the interview was that I don't think Captain Kangaroo, or I'll call him Bob Key, I don't think that he actually had a lot of experience interviewing directors. And at a certain point during the interview, he kind of ran out of questions to ask. And he said to me, he goes, well, he was kind of stumped. And he said, well, Ken, well, tell me about school. How were your grades in school? And I froze. Because in fact, I hadn't completed my degree. I left several classes incomplete. And I thought, why is the captain asking me about my grades? And I had this like weird, you know, in my mind, I thought, oh my God, Captain Kangaroo is going to like call school and get my transcript and see that I didn't finish. So I lied. And I said, well, my grades were quite good. And I talked about finishing, you know, my degree. And I lied to Captain Kangaroo, to this day, just feels like wrong, but I did it. And he was very happy to give me the job. So he didn't get my transcript and look at it.
We did have a question come in that I think is really an important one that I want you to address, because you talk about it extensively in the book. And that is, what are some of the things that have helped you in directing actors? You've referenced some of them already, but just to, you know, some other aspects of working with actors that you think are important for a director to keep in mind.
Well, again, part of what, I mean, I think that there's so many different ways to answer that question. But I mean, part of what I try and do is think of actors as sort of my allies in telling the story. I mean, part of what I try and do with a cast, especially if it's a big cast or like an ensemble, is to, you know, to make sure that everyone's on the same page. We're all telling the same story. So, I mean, I think, you know, again, I'm not an actor. So I don't try and act for anyone. I don't demonstrate what I want by acting it out. What I do time and again is simply remind an actor of what story it is that we're telling, what the story of the scene is, where we are. Again, I'm going back to the very first thing I said, is where that actor is on the journey. And it's easy to forget. It's also easy to forget when you're shooting out of order. I would say I've never in 37 years had the pleasure of shooting a script in continuity. Nobody does. You may be shooting the last scene in the first week. So it's critical for a director to kind of have in his or her mind where everybody is in their respective journeys, because it is a rare privilege to get to, you know, shoot a script, a feature film in particular, in continuity. I think that's kind of an answer to the question.
Well, one follow-up quickly, and that is, do you think it would be helpful for future directors to actually have experience as an actor?
Well, that is the big question. And in truth, as much as I loved my film school experience, the one thing I didn't study, I never took an acting class, and neither school that I went to required me as a, you know, film student to take an acting class. And as a result, when I got out of school and had the, you know, pleasure of directing for the first time on that CBS Afternoon Playhouse, I realized that I really didn't know much about talking to actors. I knew, and this is going back to a question we had earlier, I knew where to put people in the frame. I knew how to compose. I knew how to kind of organize the frame and choreograph and move people around. But I didn't know how to talk to actors and encourage them to kind of bring their characters to life from the inside out. That was something I had to learn on my feet. So I would say for an aspiring director, even if you're at a wonderful film school, make sure that you roll an acting class or two into the mix, because it will help you when it comes time to, you know, bring stories to life.
Once the threat of this masterclass started to become clear in our audience, a whole bunch of comments flooded in. So we've got Gil Hamilton says, kudos on your work. Thank you very much for your variety of creations, series, feature length, and this masterclass. Christy Orlet, something like that, says, very, very nice. Thank you. And Jessica Ambule says, thank you, Ken, Pete, and Cinema St. Louis for another opportunity to learn to shine brighter in our local industry.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
All right, well, let's bring this to a close then. We have something coming in. One last thank you, and that's from Kathleen Kaiser, or Kathleen Stanger Kaiser, since she used her middle name here. This was a fabulous masterclass. Ken, a big thank you to you, Cinema St. Louis, and Pete, too, for conducting this class. And we want to offer our thanks to Ken. We want to encourage you again to purchase his book. And again, you don't need to be somebody who wants to direct in order to take great pleasure from this book. But if you are someone who has any hopes of directing, I think it's an absolutely essential volume. I think you're gonna learn a tremendous amount, as you already know from just what he shared here during these 2 hours. But the book expands considerably on that. And it's funny, it's sometimes moving, and I think will teach you a lot about not just the film business, but about life generally. So I strongly encourage you, to pick up that book.
Thank you, Cliff. Thank you, Pete. And thank you to everyone who attended today. It was such a pleasure for me.
All right, great. And we want to remind everybody that the film festival continues through November 22nd. We just passed the midpoint of the festival at this stage. So you have plenty of opportunity to still see lots of great films. So we encourage you to continue to do that. Again, we have a masterclass with Rachel Reichman, a very talented director, editor, tomorrow at 1 p.m. And then next week, we offer classes in screenwriting with the Oscar-nominated Bo Williman, another person who has roots here in St. Louis, and also a terrific documentary course with Anne DeMar, who has a scad of credits, that including a film that we're playing here called The Girl with the Rivet Gun, which you can watch for free. It's a short documentary that deals with the real-life Rosie the Riveters, and it's a very cleverly done doc that combines animation along with documentary. And she's going to be sharing that class with Jeff Truesdell, who is a writer for People magazine, but that also was an executive producer on the terrific documentary film For Akeem that was shot right here in St. Louis. So anyway, lots of great stuff. All of that's for free. We hope that you continue to join us in the future for still more masterclasses. Thanks. Thank you, Ken. Thank you, Pete.